Welcome to Ron and Nick's Best Friend Podcast, a podcast that you cannot live without. Good morning, Ron. How are you doing today?
Can't live without it. I'm doing amazing.
Okay, we're going to start a little bit different. We're going to get a little bit of energy here. I had some praise music that I was listening to yesterday, and it's not really praise music, but it could be praise music for people that use or replace the name of our best friend in it, which is the Holy Spirit.
Every song is a love song if you got the right love.
Well, that's absolutely true. So we're going to listen. We're going to go a little bit long on this. Yeah. Here we go.
Okay.
So I know we were just doing this, okay? But we want to listen to the words just for a second, okay? Because they're really great. Here it goes.
I think I know.
Oh, you know what song this is.
For once in my life,
that's really it.
I have someone.
I didn't know you were going
to
play this.
Someone I've needed so long.
Is that the truth?
For once in my life, I can go where life leads me. Somehow I know I'll be strong. For once I can touch what my heart used to dream of long before I knew.
We're talking about the Holy Spirit right now.
Yeah.
Someone warm like you
makes you want to cry.
Would make my dream come true.
It's for you, Lord.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. For once in my life, I won't let sorrow hurt me. Not like it's hurt me before. For once, I have something I know won't desert me.
Are you smiling? People, are you smiling? This is the Holy Spirit.
For once, I can say, this is mine, you can't take it. Long as I know I have love, I can make it. For once in my life, I have someone who needs me.
I don't know if the Holy Spirit needs us, or maybe it's just a relationship. Maybe it goes both back and forth. What do you think?
No, the Holy Spirit doesn't need us.
Nah,
he just loves us.
But he wants a relationship with us.
He does.
Does it make you smile?
Yes, it does.
Could you imagine me in the middle of the night with my headphones on, my wife sleeping next to me?
Yes, I can. I can imagine you. Yeah.
You seem melancholy. What's wrong?
You
don't know where I'm going.
I have no idea where you're going.
That's
this,
the way.
This honestly seems to be going a little long to me.
No, it's not going long. No.
It is to me.
Why?
No, that's allowed. I'm allowed to feel what I feel.
Okay.
I don't look. It's great. I was just thinking while you're playing it about how we years ago we've talked about the power of Motown. If you go into a place, you go into the restaurant and Motown's playing, everybody's grooving. I was on vacation. I went to Wawa, and I walk in, and there's everybody you can imagine in the Wawa. It's all kinds of like a catch-all, right?
Yeah.
There's rednecks, and there's white people, black people, Hispanic people, Asian people, and there's a Motown song going, and I'm watching, and people are grooving. Everybody in the place, their heads going up and down. So,
listen, we got a subject that we're going to talk about, but I just want to talk about this. I'm going to keep this. This is like, you know what? It's giving me rhythm here.
Okay.
Let's talk about, before we get into what we're going to talk about for real, what you were just telling me, because I was just listening to what you were saying about the bull that constantly is hitting us each and every day, and how it's hard to sometimes focus on what's the real thing, which is the Spirit, which is the Lord, which is Jesus. But put it in the words that you were telling me, like you're just bombarded and you lose focus sometimes.
Well, Mike would have said the wrong thing is said so often that it sounds right, and then the right thing sounds wrong. And I was saying there's such a flood of that. There's just like you're over. If you stand still in this world and you don't have a relationship with the Holy Spirit and you don't hear from him, or let's just say you're neglectful in some way and you just are not paying attention, I think the flood of all the BS will drown you. It'll flow over you to the place where you'll finally just go, okay, I just give up. You know, it's too hard. It's too much. There's so much crap being said. And honestly, you know.
Okay, but you also said, but then you focus on the Spirit living in you and you know that the compass is set back on whatever.
Right, right. Well, hearing him is like, oh no, that's he's who I want. He's what he's
right.
he's who I want. He's what I want. He's going where I want to go. And it's not, and I'm not going to just go along with all of this stuff. Look, I'm not, I come across sometimes sounding like I am not an anti-church guy. I am not an anti-church guy. But Mike Wells said, Christianity without Christ is the ugliest religion in the world. And I agree with it. I 100% agree with that. If you want to see a couple of things that are accessible to everybody out there that will buttress that, is go watch Shiny Happy People on Prime. It's on Prime, I think, Amazon Prime, documentary series about the Duggar family. The other one was, and I think this is also on Prime, The Way Down Workshop documentary.
I tried to find that. I couldn't find it, but go ahead.
It's just religion. It's Christianity turned into a religion. And when it's turned into a religion, it is the ugliest thing in the world. And if those two things don't make you angry when you watch them, something's wrong with you. I mean, anybody watching it would go, okay, this is just ugly. And it is ugly. It has nothing to do with Jesus. It has everything to do with religion. And religion is what? Just a set of rules.
All right. So we've been on this thing about forgiveness. We've done like two of them, and I think we're going to do a third one here, because there was one thing that you said to me on the end. This is the third one, right? Fourth one? Really? Yep. Jeez.
This would be the fourth if you want to talk about forgiveness.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, okay. And it's one that you said to me that when you said it, I said, man, there really is tentacles of this. We're talking about self-forgiveness. Okay. And do you remember you said that?
Yeah.
Self-forgiveness. Let's talk about that. Listen, we're all dealing with this subject here one way or another, correct? I mean, there's a lot of pain out there. There's disappointment in people, what they've done to you. For me, there's a lot of disappointment in things that I've done. And I had to deal with and forgive myself. Oh, here we go. Self-forgiveness. But I think I found the right way to find forgiveness for myself. But let's talk about that. That's really interesting. I just said that. I forgave myself.
Tell me how you did that.
That's a great...
Because that's...
That's really good.
Yeah, I want to know how did you do that?
Now I'm stuck.
Do you feel forgiven? Wait.
That's really good.
Not feeling, because we went through this. Are you living forgiven?
Yes, I am.
Do you condemn your own self? Do you hold yourself in contempt?
No, I don't. I did, but I don't anymore. No, I don't. I don't. I don't know, Ron.
Well, I bet you everybody in...
I don't know.
Everybody listening, everybody in the tribe, this is a show about the Holy Spirit and a conversation with us with the Holy Spirit. That's why it's what you can't live without. That's why, because everything else that you hear has got to be measured against His voice and what He has to say. And there's going to be a flood of stuff today, and there is every day, that's going to come across you and over you and flood over you. That's going to be not Holy Spirit. It's going to be not relational. Sometimes it's going to come dressed up, like robed with the robes of the church on it, the robes of religion, the robes of the Bible, the robes of doesn't everybody believe this? And here's one of these areas that I call it the crunchy gospel, where the gospel is like, okay, your book doesn't work here. Your religious disciplines don't work here. They don't. When it comes to living a forgiven, free life, which would be free from your own offenses, free from the consequences and the, maybe not the consequences, because that's a whole different issue, but the condemnation, the slavery of unforgiveness of self, you can't have it unless you have the Holy Spirit, because He's the only one that can help you with it. You can't help yourself with it.
Okay, let's define what we're saying. So I do something, and what? I can't forgive myself for it?
Right.
I cannot forgive. So
you hold yourself in contempt.
I hold myself in contempt. And so what happens when you do something like that?
Well, when you...
I'm trying to think for my even... So I don't feel good about myself. I feel less than. I feel not worthy. I'm just thinking, you know. I'm angry, disappointed.
Right. All of the above. Angry, disappointed. Yes, yes, yes.
I can't get it out of my heart. Okay, yeah, I got it.
Well, you put yourself in a category by yourself, and you actually... Some people try to do some kind of penance. They try to do acts of service that offset. You know, you can find out if you're religious by how you handle this, because if you're religious, a lot of times you'll try to do your own works of service that'll offset your failures.
Right.
A woman has had an abortion, so she. In an attempt to find absolution and feel better about it, she goes and works at Crisis Pregnancy Center. Let's say a guy had a problem. He was abused a child. Okay, a horrible thing, obviously. But then, and this does happen. But then wants to volunteer with children because he wants to serve children, make up for his brokenness, and prove, I guess, to himself that he can be around kids and not abuse them. There's this slavery of the brokenness. Like, somehow, can I offset it? Can I do something good for kids? You know, I did this bad thing. Let me do something good. So you can tell if you're religious by how you try to handle your own forgiveness, self-forgiveness.
Wow.
We go back to the thing. What is forgiveness? Forgiveness is an act between you and God, and it's conducted between you and God, and it's a fact. And you choose. You have to choose it. So at some point, you have to choose to forgive your own self, because you can hold yourself in contempt. Let's say you yelled and screamed at your kids, and you failed in your kids. Your kids grow up, you know, they have scars from being raised in a home where, you know, you yelled and screamed, or you're an alcoholic or an addict or any other thing.
Right.
And they are living with that. Now, how do you handle it? I mean, do you want to hold yourself in contempt for the rest of your life and be enslaved by it? Or what do you want to do? So you just said it. You said you've forgiven yourself. How did that happen? You live in freedom. Now, you and I, before everyone that's listening and watching, have done contemptible things. There's no doubt. Like, there may be people in our tribe who have never done a contemptible thing, but I doubt it. I doubt it. I've done my share of contemptible things. So, you have, and I have. How are you not living in contempt of your own self?
Well, here's the thing. As you're talking, I'm sitting here living what you're telling me, okay, or what you're hearing, what I'm hearing. And this is the thing I think may ring with people that may be true. I think we can go to God. And I think we can, and I think, listen, you might have said this already, but let me just say it again. I think we can go to God. I think I've gone to God, and I've looked at him, and I see the sacrifice. Follow me. Seeing the sacrifice that he's done, the love he's given me, the love he has for me, the love that's inside of me, the spirit, and I am feeling, and I know confidently that I am forgiven, heavenly forgiven. Not even a thought. Yet, I still hold on to it. Now, I know you just said, you talked about it, but there's a disconnect here. As you were talking, I'm going, yeah, but I still feel guilty. How do you get that guilt away out of your heart? I mean, it's almost like, here's the thing. It's like, you can't, okay, God, I know you forgave me, but how can I forgive myself? I know in your eyes, I'm forgiven, but I got to hold on to it. I'm still feeling bad and guilty about it. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Well, yes, it makes perfect sense, because you've decided that while you might forgive someone else and choose, you make a choice. I forgive Sally for whatever.
Whatever.
I forgive Sally for stealing my money. Good. And now we've talked about, you've got to bear the burden of that. It's a fact. You chose. You went into God's courtroom. You said, God, I forgive Sally. Okay, so you forgave her. And you say, I'm not gonna ask for any money back. I'm not going to ask for anything.
Right.
God, you and I are going to share the burden.
Right.
You know, Jesus, your yoke is light and your burden is easy.
I feel good about that.
So
that's
you,
good.
So you feel good
I've
about
given
it.
Grace, yes.
Yeah, but with yourself, you walked into the courtroom. You said, I'm forgiven. I should be forgiven. Jesus, you do the same thing.
Right.
God, do you agree to take my rap sheet? Now it's my personal rap sheet. And God says, yes. He asked Jesus, same process. Jesus says, yes, I got that. And then you walk out and you say, but I'll pay for it. But I'll keep paying for it. And that's shame and guilt and fear. That's what you do. You when you think about it, you pay it out with, well, I should feel guilty. I should be ashamed of myself. I should be afraid of people knowing this about me.
And is that Satan manipulating? What is either, that? Is that pride?
It's the flesh. It's pride. It's, yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, yes, it's pride. It's core, and the people hate when I say this because they don't get it, is what you've done is you said, well, other people can be forgiven, but I have higher standards for my own self.
Ooh, that's it.
Yeah.
That is it.
Yeah. Yeah, you might, I forgive you for what you did to me.
You're a cheater, but not me.
Not me. No. Yeah, yeah. I hold myself to a higher standard. So,
oh my God.
So I basically say to Jesus, thanks for paying off the sin of Sally, who, stole all my money. But I'll pay off my own sin. That's what you're doing in principle. Because why? Well, I'm better than Sally. I hold myself apart. I hold myself above. It's the essence of the essence of self-forgiveness is absolute humility. It's like, I don't hold myself above anybody else. I'm just like everybody else. I give myself the same treatment that everybody else gets, and don't pay myself out with shame, guilt, and fear over and over and over again. So what's your alternative, though? Your alternative is this. Like with, we talked about other people, your name. Like my son who broke the chair, we talked about in one episode. I could rename him. Okay, you're chair breaker. And now I name him that, and I pay him out for the rest of his life as chair breaker. That's not forgiveness, because I renamed him, under his broken, under his sin or under his failure or whatever you want to call it. I can rename myself. I'm the adulterer. I'm the cheater. I'm the thief. I'm the murderer. I know a lot of women deal with that who've had abortions. And if you rename yourself that and accept that name, you've done something else that's contemptible. You've taken somebody named child of God, daughter of God, son of God, and you've renamed him. And you live like that, and it's slavery. It's you're enslaved again. So if you want to be free, you have to allow God to take the price and pay it and accept his payment for it. And then walk out of the courtroom having made the choice. I do forgive myself. It's the same process. I forgive myself. You say it out loud. I forgive myself for blank. Fill in the blank. I forgive myself. That is an act of your will. You're choosing it. When you do it, when you say it, mean it.
Mm.
I forgive myself for whatever. I forgive myself for cheating. Now, no one else has to be in the courtroom. No one else has to witness it. It's completely a transaction between you and God. And now you walk out of there. And you have a regular conversation with the Holy Spirit, because the enemy will come back and say,
absolutely.
Don't you feel ashamed? Don't you feel guilty? Don't you feel afraid someone will find out? And you can say back, I've chosen God's forgiveness. It's a fact. I chose it. You got nothing to say to me about this.
I've said this before, and you've heard me say it a dozen times, if not two dozen times. I am capable. Follow this guy. So I'm capable of doing anything, okay? I'm capable of doing anything without the prodding of the Spirit and having a relationship. I've done things in my life. Let's talk about cheating, adultery. I've done that decades ago, okay? Decade, long time ago. I put that caveat, you know, so you guys don't think I'm an adulterer now. But it's a damn truth, excuse me. It's a truth. And for a long time, you know what my problem was? This is not who I am. I cannot believe I fell trapped to this. I was not raised like this. This is not, you know what? BS. Okay, I'm capable of everything without the prodding of the Spirit. Loving the Lord, having Him part of my life. I'm capable of everything. I'm just like everybody else, okay? Is that wrong thinking or is that healthy thinking?
Our flesh is irredeemable. So God didn't have a plan to redeem your flesh and make it better. So in your flesh, you're capable of anything.
That's right.
And that is true. But you're not an adulterer. And I don't think you were saying it, but that's not your name.
No, absolutely.
That's why you're free, because you've chosen self forgiveness. Like your ex-wife can't absolve you. She can't. It wasn't up to her to say, okay, you're not an adulterer, because she can't say that. You are. The only one that can say, look, I'm going to rename you, is the Holy Spirit. He says, okay, would you give me that name? You know, murderer, a cheater, thief. Okay, give me that name, I'll give you a new name. When you walk out of my courtroom, I'll give you a better name. I'll give you a full name. I'll give you a name that transcends all names, and it's yours, and you can have it, and it has nothing to do with shame, guilt, or fear.